Ladies and gentlemen, hello and welcome back again to the Mr. Cat EU Invitational. I'm Lyrical, going to be joined as well by Gareth as we get ready to hop into the upper bracket finals of this first phase of the competition. It's Ninjas in Pajamas facing off against Pro Dota Gaming. I'm Lyrical, as I said, and yeah, Gareth, how you doing?
Yo, I'm really excited for this. You know, we finally get to the upper bracket winners match. The winner of this goes to the playoffs. You know, researching all the drafts and thinking about all the games we've cast over the past week, and all of a sudden NIP come into the lobby with a new player. And I'm like, well, shit, I don't know who this guy is. So Boxy is what looks like a Swedish player that's played with like Celery and Flensmeister and kind of the tier two sort of Swedish scene in the past and recently. Outside of that, I can't find too much information about him other than he's a mid player and he likes playing Invoker.
Right.
And he looks pretty good. His Dota Buff profile says he's 5k MMR, but that's I'm pretty sure, you know, out of date.
Let's cross our fingers and hope so.
or he's a smurf. Like I'm not sure.
Right. And that's the thing that's sort of weird is that I don't believe I've seen many information or info coming out that Koikva's left, but apparently that is the case. So I don't know, we'll end up seeing how it goes. Pro Dota Gaming, you do have the Clockwork there as well as the Terrorblade early on. These seems like incredibly strong picks. If they wanted to, also you could think about like running back a little bit later on for a Shadow Fiend and get the Cogs abuse as well, which would be lovely to see.
Oh, that'd be great. Both teams have their comfort heroes though, right? Monkey King for Hani with a Darkseer for Trixie, very aggressive plays. PD, it looks like from the first two picks they've gone for. Kind of self-medicating, a problem that I've seen from them the past couple of series. Honestly, they've been very good at kind of adapting and learning how to draft against specific teams and games. But one of their biggest problems has been that they kind of polarize themselves and go one direction or the other very hard in the early stages of their draft. They go very hard pick and play, where they'll get like Clockwork and heroes to, you know, catch people out, get a kill, then convert that into towers. Or they go too hard the other way into the five man, and they go five man and just run around and, you know, sometimes they get split pushed to death. But this way around, they've kind of got a bit of both worlds, and I kind of like that balance that PD start off with. But against NIP's classic Iron Shell Monkey King running at your heroes nonstop, you need more than just self-medication. You need a freaking war zone in front of him, because Hani goes nuts on this hero.
Yeah, it's a problem. You need to be able to deal with that in some way, form, or fashion. And maybe something that you could think about doing is the Earthshaker pulls again on the offlane. We've seen this time and again out of Pro Dota. I don't know if it's something that's as good since there's the Monkey King in the game, and maybe that's part of the reason why NIP end up taking it as well. Although they do decide to ban out the Venge. Interesting. It's just more things to ramp up the damage at the TB.
That is an interesting one. Usually PD would run the Garter Venge. I don't see them often running the support Venge, but I guess with Milan and J4 kind of switching between their roles, the four and five role get, you know, maneuvered between them, whether they're playing Spirit Break or Maiden, Witch Doctor, they do tend to switch their heroes up. But I'd be more afraid of, you know, this Clockwork position, potentially transitioning into the four role. We've seen that a fair amount where Clockworks have been roaming around. J4 has done it. Milan could pick up the Dazzle. And we could still be waiting to see what 3-3 takes into the offlane.
Yeah, no, totally. And that's something that we saw as Clockwork do a lot of work before, but it's not necessarily the be-all, end-all. There's other options for him here as well. Is there anything that you would maybe like to see out of the offlane? Just kind of depend on what the safe lane hero is that comes out from NIP, since you do have the last pick for Pro Dota Gaming.
5 seconds remaining.
They don't really have a good answer to Monkey King right now. You know, Dazzle's a good reactive support, can TP and save you from Monkey King ganks. If Clockwork's the four roll, maybe you have a bit of a better time just kind of, you know, tracking him down where he's making these movements. But for 3-3 with Batrider, Magnus, Clockwork all gone, I don't think he plays Nature's Prophet that often, but I'd like to see, you know, Furion have that global presence, be able to jump into these fights, adds more split push, but also the kind of gang up five man, you know, alleviates all of their problems, kind of ticks all the boxes as a hero from the offlane. Outside of that, maybe a Faceless Void. Yeah. You're looking at NIP here, who are kind of, you know, looking at fighting around choke points with Vacuum, Monkey LT, with the Wukong's Command. Having something like a Void that allows both TB and Lina to launch all their damage inside of the bubble and disrupt NIP while they're trying to set up a team fight could be big.
I'm going to mention this real quickly, too, that this is going to be, I think, the first game. They've played five different games this week, Ninjas in Pajamas, it looks like. And every single one of them, they've had a Terrorblade as the carry. So they're going to have to switch things up. They're going to need to find a new answer because that one was already taken away by Proto to Game 8. And it's going to be the Weaver, at least for now.
Yeah, likely the era Weaver with Trixie already on the docks here. So the last hero will probably be for Boxy mid. At least that's where I'm assuming he'll be heading to. Invoker would be my shout. You know, looking at his Dota buff profile for 5 seconds shows that Invoker is his most played hero. And outside of that, it's like Tinker, Puck, Shadow Fiend kind of thing. The TA ban there, you know, good against the leaner in lane, would be difficult to gank with Clockwork and Dazzle. Just offers so many options to outlane your opponents. But NIP... I kind of feel like you ban another offlaner. I think you ban like Nature's Prophet or Void or something like that because of the fear that Clockwork brings.
Right. The Clockwork support you mean brings.
Yeah. Well, it's like the fear that Clock could be offlane and could be support. Like, I think it's more natural here to ban out. Maybe you can think about banning out the Earth Spirit because you have a Weaver as well. You know, the combo there is nice with the stun silent.
Yeah,
it's honestly like the hardest part in a draft. I guess Nyx that can fit both slots, right? Yeah. You can fit three or four is a better option.
Yeah, well, and I think that it's a scarier hero than almost any other support would be. Like, there aren't many supports, with the exception of like Chenner and Chantress, that completely change the dynamic of the game. Maybe a Shadow Shaman or something, but I don't know if that's something that Pro Dota really would want to run for themselves. Remaining. For NIP right now. Mid hero, there is still the Invoker, as you mentioned. Puck is another option here, with Ember already being banned out. I don't know if there's really any other great answers against Lina. I gotta take the OD.
Radiant team. I was wondering where they go, because with the first four heroes, they kind of have this. You know, it's not high tempo, not slow tempo. It's pretty much just right in the middle tempo. You know, they've got a couple,
Oh God. But apart from. You went crazy for a second, but you're back. Sorry.
10 seconds remaining.
Okay, now I brushed my cable on the microphone, and apparently that sent it into a.
Do you want to hear what you sounded like?
I sounded like a helicopter, I bet.
Yeah, you went.
Yeah, it does that sometimes. Fuck, what was I saying? Oh yeah, they don't have like a, you know, a fast tempo, we're gonna run at you non-stop lineup. They don't have a slow, steady, we're gonna farm items. It's kind of in the middle where they want the first sort of 6-7 minutes to tie in with their opponent's Terrorblade. You know, he needs his time to farm up his items. But then they hit this real big peak, you know, when Darkseer has his mech arcanes, they have Monkey King with, you know, a Basher or something. They've got high mobility as well as very good team fight. Lots and lots of raw damage that comes out of NIP. But I feel like if they get caught into this five-man versus five-man, PDA can kind of out-sustain them. And now with Nightstalker, when it hits that nighttime and he has his Aghanims, they're going to have the vision advantage over NIP as well. Also, very, very good against Monkey King. I was worried about them not having anything to deal with the MK, you know, jumping around in the trees.
Right.
It doesn't offer you anything early game, but mid to late game, definitely.
Yeah. No, and I think that it's going to be... early game, it's not going to offer much, but he can still make things happen around, like, you know, that 4-minute mark, right? I mean, Nightstalker is great at being able to gank, and I could see him very easily running in and causing some trouble for OD in a matchup that, at least for me, I don't know if OD really does that well against Lina, because you can just sort of spam out slaves on him, right? It's not the easiest matchup in the world.
You just right-click as Lina, like, the way you win lanes as Lina or Death Prophet is not really through lane manipulation or shoving waves or, you know, out-farming. It's literally just more efficient regen trading, especially in the first, like, two or three waves. Because you have that extended attack range, you just, you know, right-click, three or four, then you have the Dragon Slave to actually kill off range creep, which OD doesn't. He has to walk up and astral the range creep to get an experience advantage.
Right.
So Kaiser should definitely have the laning matchup here.
God, I played a game against Lina the other day, and I was playing Storm Spirit, and it made me sad. He picked up... what did he pick up? He picked up a Blightstone. Like, a Blightstone first, and just punched me over and over again. It was so demoralizing playing that Storm Spirit. I mean, it's not like it's an easy matchup anyways, but... Ugh. Anyways, we're getting into this game. It's Pro Dota facing off against Ninjas in Pajamas. Gareth, I'm going to put you the tough question. Who's winning this one? Who do you feel like it's going to be?
Ooh, the series or this game number one?
Let's go game number one.
I like PD's draft more. Okay. I feel like they're going to win, but it's very close.
All right.
Like, I think PD, like, I think PD won the draft, like, 65-35, but I think NIP, with maybe, better sort of strategy and experience to know what to do. The big question mark for me is Boxy on the mid lane, this OD. I think that is, like, the biggest reason why I'm favoring PD, is that I don't know Boxy, I don't know how well he's going to play. OD against Lina is an unfavorable matchup as well, so there's going to be a lot of, required pressure from Hany on this Monkey King to move into the mid lane to help him out. But then he's going to be chased by the Nightstalker. You know, there's all these question marks around NIP's draft and heroes. Can they get the items they need in time? Are they going to hit by the fast tempo of PD too early for them?
Yeah. Well, and I think that it's, I don't know, the thing to me that's most interesting about this also is that we've got, like,
30 seconds.
I remember watching a game just the other day. It was SG Esports, and they were playing, and they ended up having a stand-in. And it was a stand-in by, like, necessity. They didn't have anybody else. I do wonder if that's the case here, or if this is, somebody that they've been excited about, bringing onto their roster, or what exactly is going on. And is that drop period, roster changes abound. There's a lot of question marks around. I don't want to feel the fire too much, but something to think about there, as the Cogs are not going to push the Monkey King down.
Yeah, you're exactly right. We looked at Insania replacing Syndra, and it felt natural that Mickey kind of joined the team in the interim and was playing with Insania. It felt good. They were winning games. So I don't know if, Koikva and or Mickey, they've not been accepted to the team or gone on vacation or, I've heard lots of things about Koikva, still being in the team and not being in the team at the same time. There's lots of little things that you hear that he's on vacation or he's, still going to go to school and things like that.
Right.
So I don't know if this Boxy guy is, brand new, fresh blood that they found, that they've been playing with, and like you said, they kind of want to test him out, or if he is just here to fill the slot.
Right. Well, early movement around the map. You do see, of course, the clockwork. It's because of that last pick, Nightstalker going to be 3-3 on it, and, Rubick's a pretty good answer for the clockwork. That's not easy to deal with, and down bottom... how do you feel like the Terrorblade deals with the Darkseer?
He's pretty good. With Metamorphosis early on, you can shove the Darkseer out of lane. Kaiser's in trouble mid, though, a little bit.
Yeah. A couple of quick right-clicks now. He actually isn't going to be able to eat his happy little tree either. So, you never like to see that. There was one more left over there on the high ground. And Monkey King, just going to be driven away for the moment by the Nightstalker as well.
What an insane hero. So yeah, TBE with Metamorphosis is very good at forcing the Darkseer away. I'm kind of surprised that Trixie was able to get level 2 with the supports down there on the Terrorblade, but he's managed to kind of weasel himself into Surge. Garta held on to Metamorphosis, so didn't feel like it was necessary to use it too early on. But with Quelling Blade and, high base attack, the fact you've got lots of armor to tank creep waves, you're usually fine just, hitting the Iron Shell creep or dragging it back to tower. And with the Dazzle behind you, it's even easier.
Right. Can see again the Monkey King, Hany, just wanting to do what he can to help out the mid lane here. It seems, though, as if the OD is already having a great time of it. 10-5 versus the 4-0. And there's Trixie coming back into lane yet again. The creep wave ended up getting pushed down underneath the tower and then, of course, comes back out towards him. But J4 will manage to find this pull here, and it's stacked up as well. See if Trixie can get a good Iron Shell off onto this, or if he just tries to pull the creep wave back into his favor. But, looks like they're not really going to be able to contest him too much, though. He should be able to get a lot out of this.
Yeah, he's just going at it. I want to say mid lane is a very, very good example, like textbook example of proactive versus reactive play. Lina's on the back foot and losing in CS because Hany was the first one to make a move. I don't have 3-3. Yeah, he should be okay here, right?
There's the lift out and push away, trying to go for the cogs. Well, Insania is still taking some extra damage there, but they will force him back again.
So yeah, Hany was the first one to make a move with the Monkey King, and Milan's Nightstalker had to TP and react once or twice to try and counteract what he was doing. But the damage had already been done to Kaiser, the fact that Monkey was off-map and hiding, and the threat was there that the Lina has to kind of sit back and not play that kind of harassive, aggressive, I'm going to pepper you with right clicks onto the OD. So Boxy's had a really good laning stage, all thanks to Hani. And Hani is now moving up to top to try and find that kill onto 3-3, which they've been so desperately trying to grab.
Yeah. They brought down the Darkseer fairly low in the bottom lane there, and you do have 3-3. Gonna get that damage now out onto him. Bugs is there as well. The pullback with the cogs and immediate TP away. They are gonna get the Boundless Strike. 3-3, never stood a chance.
Even with the poor man's shield. It's a good attempt, though. Trouble is, Hani's level 2 already, so he's able to cancel a TP. Apparently, according to the NIP manager, they are using Boxy because Mickey is having exams.
Ah, okay. All right, that makes sense then.
Well. Yeah, like I was saying, it felt so natural that Mickey was playing with him. I'm pretty sure he's gonna be a mainstay of the team. He looks so good.
Yeah. Excellent. Well, and so, you know, it's all good. You want to make sure that you... I like that, too, that you're willing to take that opportunity to, you know, not only prioritize Dota, you know, and show that an organization is willing to commit to you as a person more so than just a player. But that's sort of going off on another little tangent. First nighttime, we have an Invis rune now in Milan. He's level 2 only, but... Yeah, it seems unlikely to find this kill since you don't have the silence.
Yeah, it's super difficult. Lina is still level 4 as well. You know, you'd love the Laguna Blade to actually kill off the OD, but with close to 800 HP, you just don't have the raw damage to do it. And you're still afraid of where NIP are hiding their support. Insania and Hani have been now off map for a good 30-40 seconds after passing Observer Ward top and moving back to their base. But this smoke could lead them anywhere. They could aggressively play bot lane, mid lane, safe lane, wherever they want to. Milan, though, fortunately for his team, will tank the smoke, reveal them, and get away.
Hmm. I mean, that's almost worth it in its own right. But I guess that you don't, as a support Night Stalker, it's not like completely imperative that you get a ton of kills in the early game. Obviously, off lane, it's a different scenario, although you might end up being in a little bit of trouble now. He's still so fast. I don't think that they can really find this kill into Milan. It's just going to deal some damage to Insania, and maybe they bring in some more there. The Lina trying to find it. He actually misses the Light Strike right now and trying to go for the body blocks. Now Milan may be in a little bit of trouble, but they're coming in with J4 as well, trying to bring down Hani. They will find that one kill with Kaiser. We'll see if they can run down Boxy as well. Maybe in some trouble. Tried to go for the juke back. They do miss the Light Strike right, but they will find two. Pro Dota. Big plays.
Yeah, dodging the LSA after Void there is a good job by Boxy, you know, showing his understanding of what's happening, but there's just three heroes that he has to walk through in order to do so, and then you've got Shadow Wave boxing him in, doing all the damage in that AoE. Kaiser with the double nulls now should start to come into his own in this game, and OD will start to suffer a little bit more, because OD's going to go for the Midas. You know, he's going to go for that build-up play, the ramp into the mid-game, into the late-game. Whereas Kaiser will be looking for, you know, the Arcanes into Bloodstone, Shadowblade. It's much more simple to build up Lina. Whereas OD, I feel, has a lot more, you know, question marks about what you should build. Four staff is definitely going to be one of them, though. And I'm honestly a little bit surprised that he's not rushing it. We've seen a lot of ODs rush the four staff against Clockwork and skip the Hand of Midas just so you can play on tempo with the rest of your team.
Maybe a little bit of unfamiliarity with that hero, and... we'll see if it ends up coming back to bite them. The bottom lane is where maybe some more rotations could have come for a kill, but Milan is now in the area. They spotted him out, I believe, and he might be in a little bit of trouble. They do have an Astral available. They're going to catch him now, and, well, we'll see if they can bring down this Night Stalker. There should be more than enough for the kill.
That's still worth it for Milan, I feel. This Night Stalker is level 3, and he hasn't really been seen to do too much apart from like little roams around, but he's broken a smoke gank that was aimed for the mid lane. He's dragged four heroes down towards the bottom shrine, and now they scan, watching for Monkey King and Rubik coming in towards the mid. So all of these little actions and movements, Milan has, you know, died once, he's got two assists, and he's not really that leveled for 7.5 minutes in the game, but he's kind of disrupting what NIP's game plans are. And in the meantime, there's this hero that we haven't really looked at for a long time. TB Garter is still farming away on the spot lane.
Yeah. Oh, Kaiser gonna be pushed down to the low ground, but Void is gonna be there. He does not have a TP, and Dragon Slate from the low gun will find that kill. Yeah, and it's just a lot of space being made by everybody else. So if Garter does move in for, you know, a big metamorphosis play, he can go down bottom if he wants to, take down that tower potentially if they can actually manage to find a kill onto Trixie. If this Darkseer goes down, that tower will fall.
Radiant's top tower. Yeah, and also the other big factor is if you, you know, if you one-to-one compare a farmed TB at, let's say, 15 minutes
right.
with a Weaver that's farmed at 15 minutes, which hero would you rather have?
I mean, I like to play Weaver, and I don't like to play TB, but I get what you're saying. In terms of a pro game, I'd rather have the TB.
You'd rather have the TB, right?
Yeah, you know, totally.
He just does so much more, because Weaver likes to go for those kind of transition items where you go for Lincolns to help you split push, it's defensive. Not going to go for the Dragonlance Desolator build this game. Maybe aims for like a Diffusal Blade or something, but will likely need a Hurricane Pike of his own on Era's Weaver just to deal with this clockwork. Mm-hmm. While TB will be, you know, pushing towers, destroying buildings, looking for big team fights.
Right. And we've seen just how out of control that guy can get if he does win a couple of team fights on top of having a nice laning stage. Not to mention the infusion of gold that you get from taking down towers. And it looks like they are going to be making that movement now into the top lane to see if they can bring down safe lane tower. Insania is still here as the Fade Bolt to try and push it out, and Clockwork with Hook available. He could certainly make some type of a play up here.
They don't really want the Rubick, but they've read this really nicely. NIP, they shift three heroes bottom to apply pressure to the opponent's tier 1 safe lane. So this is actually going to work out pretty nicely for NIP, honestly. Dire's top
tower is under attack. I
do want to point out, though, that OD did go back to Treads. He switched up. He's not going for the Hand of Midas.
Okay.
I'm really happy.
Yeah. The thing I'm wondering is if after they take the tier 1 tower, you still are going to have a little bit of duration left on this Metamorphosis. Maybe you TB with the TP to... Are you TP with the TP to mid? Think about going there.
That's definitely an option. You're still a little bit afraid of what NIP do after taking your bot tier 1 because you've basically granted full control of your jungle to the opponents. But you look at the kind of warding spread here, it's pretty much mirror image from Radiant and Dire. Radiant have taken control of Dire jungle and warded it up, warded the shrine, warded everywhere. Dire have done pretty much the same thing.
Oh, we're about a minute and a half away from nighttime. You don't have darkness yet, but Kaiser is moving down here with an invis rune. They are going to back out the rest of NIP, and a good decision to do just that.
Milan is just strolling around underneath Hani. I don't know if he realizes what's going on here. It's just a monkey right above him.
What a guy. He's just not afraid. He doesn't care. Hani. Trixie actually took a lot of damage there. It looks like he took a heal bomb to the face and then poison touch as well. And I mean, he does have stick charges, but he's going to be forced back again.
Yeah, he's closing in very quickly on his mech, though. So Trixie's going to be okay in terms of, like, grand scheme of things.
Right. And you do have the OD again, who's getting more and more farmed. They're able to stack up a couple camps here into the jungle. This helps a little bit towards the jungling of the OD. That's something that's pretty nice as well. A hero that normally doesn't farm very well. And it looks like they have found J4. No mana for Grave, no TP either. This should be another kill. See how much space he can create, though.
We're starting to see this a lot more from teams.
Insania, what? Insania, they actually ended up... They broke the tree that the Monkey King was on when they left him with the telekinesis, and now Insania is going to end up dying. J4 is still chasing... is still going to be able to get away from this. Monkey King was looking to chase him. Oh, that was a pretty big misplay there.
He also had Weave on him. Like, he had plus 20 armor, pretty much, when he was running away, so... The right clicks coming out from the Rubick were doing absolutely nothing.
Yeah. Well.
And nighttime once again. But yeah, we've been seeing this move a lot from pro teams, like, well, way a lot more recently. It was the sort of, you know, 5-roll support pushing a lane on his own split pushing used to be a move reserved for, you know, like PGG or Demon or someone, you know, that are kind of crazy. Oh god, what's he doing? But being able to get that much farm on a support that would be kind of constricted and strangled by his own team, he can't farm jungle, there's no other lanes he can go to. Just getting like, you know, 8-9 CS is amazing.
Yeah. Well, and they're thinking about going in right now. They take a little concerted move towards the top lane. Unfortunately, the TPs rotate in, and Garter has already popped Metamorphosis, so they're going to need to figure out what they want to do. Lightstrike Ray, they actually connect now onto the Weaver, and he's just going to drop. He ended up getting silence after the fact, just walked into that one. Oh man, that's really, really bad. And unfortunately, all that vision in the area, because of this ward, gives them an easy pickoff on the Weaver, and now they might even be able to pressure tier 2 even more.
Plus 125 cast range with Nightstalker during nighttime. Ira didn't know what hit him.
Yeah.
The LSA came from so far away.
Oh, and Hani getting body blocked by the creeps, and now instead they're going to find Trixie. He's going to drop as well. OD has been able to catch here, but it's just onto the Nightstalker. I think you take this trade willingly, and you might not even get him. Oh, Boundless Strike forward, trying to get that kill. The OD Arcane Orb will find him in the end.
Yeah, and that's pretty much full staff done. It's actually completed now for the OD, so he's never going to get caught completely off guard by the clockwork hookshot. But again, PD just running rampant through into enemy zones of the map, you know, killing off Darkseer before he can get his mech complete is a huge bonus for them. But then they switch back very quickly. You know, it wasn't a 5v5 brawl. They force TPs from NIP top, they disengage, and they are immediately, while Milan was running away, you know, while he was caught by the OD over here, they already had people farming mid, farming bot lane, actually farming jungle, and being more efficient than NIP could ever dream of being.
Right. And it's still the problem of this Terra Blade that's getting further and further out of control. Ended up going for the health regen instead of the attack speed, just wanting to make sure that he can consistently jungle and stay active on the map. Milan pops his first darkness now at level 6. Is there much that they're really looking to get done at this point, or do you think Prodota just want to kind of sort of sit back and relax and get that next tier of items before their next push?
I don't think they sit back and relax. They always have to be very wary of, you know, NIP grouping up and looking for objectives themselves. Roshan is like never going to be a threat in the next sort of 5-6 minutes from NIP, I don't feel. Maybe the bot tier 1 would be a nice bit of bonus gold for PD to take, but it's not the most important tower strategically. Right. I think they'd much rather go for, you know, a tier 1 mid and then retake control of the enemy jungle, get some more wards down in that dire jungle, because the one they do have right now is about to expire and doesn't give that much vision over the opponents.
Right. Oh, and then, but like, I was going to say that likewise for Injustice, as you were talking about it, the four staff is done for OD as well, and it looks like he is just finishing off or trying to finish off the Dragonlance, so maybe they can be the ones to make that next move as well, as you were talking about.
I think NIP are the ones that are more maybe, you know, safe in thinking that they can sit back and farm their next items, because there are definitely items that they need to come up. Trixie's mech is probably the biggest one,
right?
But there's also the Lincolns. Ira did go back for the Dragonlance, which I really do love. The early fighting, but also tankiness on that Weaver is amazing for him. But needs the Lincoln Sphere for sure to help deal against, you know, Sunder, Laguna Blade, but more importantly, the silence from Nightstalker, which is being an absolute pain in this fight. That's why I kind of feel that PD should go for, you know, the tier 1 mid or bot grab and try and force NIP into, you know, reacting and do what they did before, but it's actually going to be NIP the smoke.
Hmm. Maybe just looking for a short pickoff or something, because like you said, you know, they don't have that mechanism. Actually, it is just now brought up, so maybe this is that time. You know, you have the surge forward, you've got wall, 4 points up in vacuum. There's things that can be done here, and they're going to try and pressure this top tier 1 tower. I believe that Dazzle is dead. There's going to be Force Staff already used, and oh, if they're not careful. All right, now there's no rotations in from the rest. It's just going to be one dead.
For a second there, I thought that the, you know, rainbow of TPs was going to come in. Two people did start a TP, but one canceled, and only Milan joined.
No.
But that is such a slow return of investment for such
Vacuum wall in the mid lane. They've actually found one, but they do hit the light strike right onto Boxy. Still the boundless strike is there, but now OD is silenced. He doesn't have all that damage that you would normally want out of it. Now 3-3 as well as Milan on top of him. They might be biting off more than they could chew though. Boxy walking away from him. TB Illusion still there in the rocket flare. Will find the kill. They are going to pay for it though, as 3-3 is getting ran down. But Lina already back into this fray and wanting to take these heroes down. Does have Soul Ring as well as Laguna Blade just outside of range, hasn't popped it as of yet. The Shrine is there as well, going to use it now, and another Boundless Strike coming in. There's going to be the Grave. They have the bugs all over him. There's almost going to be a dead Trixie, but he gets away on nothing, and Hani also able to escape, so ends up looking sort of like a mixture. I'd still say a little bit in the favor of Ninjas and Pajamas, though, despite OD going down.
Yeah, they get the 2-for-1 trade. I'm struggling to think of actually who comes out on top. Like, gold-wise, NIP definitely do. But strategically,
yeah.
I kind of feel that PD didn't use Metamorphosis there. They're waiting for the next fight. You know, they baited out the Vacuum Wall. Santi's Eclipse is now down. They can pretty much go for tier 1 mid and bot at their will. It's free for them, pretty much.
Okay.
Because they've got Hookshot ready up and ready again. They've got Bloodstone and Lina. This is, like, prime time to fight for them.
That's something I wanted to mention, too. That fight went up in the top lane where OD ended up four-staffing forward. I expected the rotation in from 3-3 to try and punish it, but he actually had used the hook shot on Hani in the bottom lane, so I think it was a pretty good recognition for them as well. We don't have to try and force this fight. Let's take the good fight and make sure it's on our own terms. And then it ended up working for him.
Yeah, you know, losing a support top, losing a support in offlane mid, you kill the OD, and it's a 1-for-3 trade, you know, in the extension of the team fight that moved from top to mid lane. So I think it's okay for PD to be, you know, relatively happy with this. Milan is still getting a lot of experience and a decent amount of gold heading into the hand of Midas, it looks like. But J4 on the Dazzle is incredibly farmed for a 5-roll hero.
Absolutely. And having that urn, nice little bit of tankiness. He is going to weave himself up again. Does have some heals that can come out as well. And they're bringing in Lina. Got to be careful. Hookshot has found now onto Trixie. He gets pushed up onto the high ground. He's going to end up dying to that. Tried to get the vacuum off to clip a couple of them as well. But it didn't happen. So wall expended for basically nothing. You don't have your Darkseer mechanism in the rest of this fight. And now they're going to chase down a little bit further onto OD, or at least force him back. And maybe a tier 2 tower in the works.
Oh, they nearly had Monkey King as well there. Hani got clipped on one of the trees. They know where he is, but they can't really go for him. But yeah, immediately when Trixie got caught there, he's in the cogs and he gets pushed out. Straight after him dying, like I'm talking within 1.5 seconds, he put four staff on his quick buy and bought half of it. He's like, screw this, I'm done with being trapped in cogs.
Yeah.
I need some mobility. And they honestly need it in so many different heroes. I think Rubick needs one. Era might need one himself, but this is the struggle now, is defending your towers against the
Oh no, Trixie, you walked right into hell! Right-click's coming, the mech is there, but there is nothing left! He gets a vacuum onto two, which is, well, a thing, but now, well, they picked off Kaiser, maybe they can get some more here. Era's on top of him! Boxy from the low ground takes down another couple of kills. There's Dazzle dropping Milan. Looks like he's going to be able to escape from this one. And 3-3 able to get the four staff to the high ground as well. Looked a decent.
That was insane. I didn't actually catch Boxy killing off Kaiser there, but removing Lina, the biggest single damage source of PD, immediately from the fight was huge for them, you know. Again, another great trade for NIP. They're getting a lot of gold over on their heroes that need the gold. Era and Boxy are sitting, you know, relatively good on the net worth. They're you know, being eclipsed by the TB a little bit, but Lina isn't that far ahead, and with only 8 Bloodstone charges now heading into the Shadow Blade for that maneuverability.
I mean, that's the thing, right? Is that if you end up giving away that early Bloodstone kill. Ooh, Era? All right. Well, that hurts. Milan, on the other hand, though, he did end up picking up the Hand of Midas recipe, so it's not all terrible. Like, you can take a couple of those pickoffs, and it actually probably is going to signal to them that there's a ward in the area as well, although it is about to get taken down. Anyways.
Well, TB nearly had the Monkey King.
Oh, this is a kind of an interesting little thing, too. Yeah, the reflection chasing the Monkey King no matter where he goes. You can find out what tree he's on.
Flying illusions. That's some good stuff. They've got Rocket Flare as well to scout him out. You know, one of Clockwork's greatest strengths is having that vision ability. 3-3. Four staff and Hand of Midas. This Clockwork is going to get big. Incoming!
No. Not quite there yet, obviously, but we've seen this guy get out of control on this hero throughout these qualifiers, and they're still first phasing it and still working.
For now.
Okay. Do you not believe in the Clockwork first phase?
Oh no, I think it's super strong. I just feel that, you know, people buying four staffs makes the hero so difficult to play because you need to be very picky with the target that you go for. Okay, I thought Hani gets caught there, but he's fine. Milan finds Insania though. This is a really split fight.
Yeah, it could get a little bit testy. They have the pushback from 3-3 as well, and Well, Light Strike Ray stolen by Rubick, the vacuum wall into the Insanity's Eclipse. Oh my god, Garner ends up getting off the combo, but the stolen Light Strike Ray doing so much right there, and now they're chasing down Garner. Dazzle nowhere in sight. Oh wow. Oh wow, wow, wow. Insania making it plays. Oh,
and the Lincolns is there as well, dude. He tries the Manta out, but Era's ready for him. Insania with the LSA, Dragon Slave, just stealing everything. But it's Trixie, the Vacuum Wall combo. They bait PD into a fight that they have no right taking near Shrine, near High Ground, near a choke point. And what did we say during drafts, dude? Yeah. What did we say during the draft? That PD so often get caught into polarizing themselves. You know, I think they have drafted nicely here. I think they have a nice mix of split push, catch and kill, taking objectives straight after. Sure, it looks all great. But if at any point you find yourself thinking, right, let's five-man smoke, group up into one cluster of heroes and walk into darkness, because they have no vision there over NIP, I think you're making like a huge mistake. That is like a massive rookie mistake, is walking into a Darkseer where you have no vision.
I know, it's tough. And, you know, they'll take a minute here to think about their choices in life and figure out exactly what they want to do. Yeah, Jesus. You mentioned in the draft, if they get baited into these 5-on-5 engagements, life is going to be tough for them. They've not only here got, like, you know, vacuum wall into Boundless Strike, which is a pretty easy setup, I would say. That one's not as hard to do as some of the others. You just need to time it right. But then also the combo that comes out with having Rubick steal and make these big plays. Even if you like get a lift up on Telekinesis and then the land stun can sometimes end up being comboed, although that one is far less likely. Yeah, I feel like that was such a big momentum swing. I mean, look at the graph just over one fight.
I mean, even Sanity's Eclipse, you know, stealing mana from your opponents or just nuking them outright. There was, what, four people in that vacuum, four of them got hit by the Sanity's Eclipse, and four of them freaking died. Lina even tried to suicide to heal her teammates in the middle of that, which was, you know, a sick attempt by Kaiser, but it didn't really work out as intended. Everyone still dropped very, very quickly, unfortunately for them. But NIP still have a lot of work to do. You know, that's a great bonus for them. They flipped this 4,000 net worth lead that PD had, and 3,000 experience lead into a lead of their own, actually, flipping the table completely on that one. But net worth lead moving down to zero. They still have this big fat TB up at the top, which is scary as all hell, and he's moving into a BKB to deal with the OD's damage as well as that vacuum combo. But Lina, 5 Bloodstone charges now. Things are starting to slow down, and this is a hero that needs to continue, you know, continue farming, continue finding kills, more importantly.
Yeah. Oh, and yeah.
Shadow Blades, it does help. No, it does help her hunt people.
I just realized also that was the 9-kill pro Dota into 4-man wipe. So I'm sure there's going to be some people a little bit upset about that.
The first 10 kills. Yeah.
Oh, that hurts. Yeah, OD, apparently there's still some confusion as to what's going on. Hopefully NIP, everything is all fine for them. Looks like they are indeed going to be ready to go. And I mean, still a little ways away from the Night Stalker getting done his Hand of Midas, as up towards top, they're looking to try and chase down this Dazzle. Zania's got some damage for him, as well as a little bit of help from Era. And the extended 5-man wipe that took place over a little bit of time, they missed the hook shot. Oi, 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 oi.
Yeah. Not too much they can do there. Again, it's only the Dazzle dying and he got some CS for it. Giving the gold away to Rubick and Weaver isn't very good for them, though. Rubick's getting closer and closer to Blink Dagger, but Era on the Weaver, you know, talks a lot about the kind of weaknesses of this hero and how you wouldn't want the Weaver to kind of face up 1v1 against TB if you were farmed. But with Dragonlance into Lincolns, and now, yeah, he's heading into the Diffusal Blade, which I absolutely love on this hero, you have so much damage. You can just, you know, focus down on the Dazzle, the Nightstalk, you can kite people really heavily. I think NIP people still struggle a little bit to deal with the TB illusions if they don't have this OD mega farmed, and well, BKB is his next choice to, again, deal with the silences and the nuke damage coming out of Nightstalker and Lina. But I'm still waiting for PD to make their move. It feels like this entire game, from laning stage through to now, they've been the ones getting baited, getting kited, kind of walking into forced errors when Tier 1 tower bot is still standing. You know, and a kind of easy access point for them. An easy push on Tier 1 bot should be relatively simple.
Yeah. I sort of splurged out there for a moment. If you look at this camp over here, do you see where I'm drawing on the map?
Yes.
Yeah, that made me really sad.
Oh, that makes me angry. That
right?
Make me sad.
It made me really mad. Oh.
Because, no, but the thing is, if I go and farm enemy jungle and I'm feeling particularly asshole-ish, uh-huh. You know, I'll always leave a satyr or... But they have to be full HP. You can't leave it on one HP.
No,
you have to leave them full HP satyr.
OD left that. OD left
that's
that.
Bad.
That, yeah. That's like, it made me really mad. But we're getting into another fight here. Era, he's chasing. That is going to be smoke broken. J4, always the one to end up going down. Although, will he this time trying to go for the TP? But Era is the boundless strike, and yeah, he was gone.
They're giving up their dazzle for information. They see five NIP heroes. They've got TB pushing top lane, Lina pushing bot lane. Again, this kind of trade is perfect for PD. They don't really care too much for the Dazzle dies, and it's what, like a 400 gold swing or something like that? Dazzle losing 200 gold is nothing. But losing Roshan is a big deal.
Yeah, and OD being that guardian here off to the side to make sure that he's able to block it off. They are still going to have vision of this. Clockwork moving into position, wants to try and make the play. They could go for the catch. He's going to jump in, but Nera, he's already picked up the Aegis in 3-3. Four staffed away, almost going to go down, and he is going to fall. There's too much damage coming in from that OD, and these past couple of minutes have just gone from bad to worse to terrible for Pro Dota as Milan trying to chase around a courier, but will not catch it. Instead, it's going to be NIP. Well, actually, losing a tower.
Oh, now it's on the tier two. Okay. Good luck, Milan.
He's thinking about it. He wants it. Oh, what? What?
No.
What? How do you just do that?
That is unacceptable. Nightstalker is not permitted to do things like this.
Yeah. Well, it happens. You lose your courier. There is still going to be some pressure here towards the mid, but it looks like they are not going to fully stick around. I would imagine, at least. You don't have everybody here. It could get a little bit scary. Yeah, they're going to back out a bit.
Hani is kind of showing off the newish Monkey King build that a lot of pros have been going for now, is the treads into Solar Crest. He skipped out on the Aquila, which is kind of interesting. Maybe just wanted the solo faster. But without mana regen, you can struggle a little bit, but he's got the magic wand to supplement that at touch. But you know, he's not gone for the phase boots, Aquila, Urn, Basher, or the Basher rush build. Solar Crest has become so important, especially against a hero like Terrorblade. If he's focusing down onto one target, you put the Solar Crest buff on them and they become close to invulnerable, honestly.
Yeah. I literally like it. I wonder if we are going to get a big patch pretty soon, because I feel like this item just does need to be addressed. It's so good for pushing high ground also, and just everything. They have been able to find now this Night Stalker, so Milan going to end up dropping. Actually, pop the BKB for that one, trying to run down Garter, but he's just going to give him a little opiope and head out of there.
Yeah, I mean, when you see Night Stalker plus a Terrorblade on your side of the map in jungle where you have no vision around them, I feel like popping BKB there is an incredibly heads-up move. You don't know if you're going to get hookshotted or if there's an Invis Lina nearby. You know, if you get hit by an LSA, there's the potential that you straight up die. Kaiser, speaking of, has just been rocketed by his teammate.
Well, they found Insania. Yep, that is a little bit of an issue. 3-3 is going to get vacuumed back in. Thought it was going to work, but it was a bold move.
Yeah, I'm not sure what that plan was. Kaiser was hiding in the trees. They knew that there were a number of NIP heroes around. Going deep in for that kind of move as a clockwork against, what, two force staffs? One on Darkseer, one on OD. Against Telekinesis, Vacuum, Weaver, Shikuchi. There is almost no way you get kills in this game as a clockwork alone.
Yeah. Need that extra bit. But also, the thing is like, I guess, I don't know, I'm trying to figure out like a good thing for them to do right now, and honestly, Pro Dota's moves seem like there isn't really a great one. You sort of have to wait out the, you know, this timing that's so strong until you can get the Aghanims up for the Night Stalker in a way, right?
Yeah, there's a lot of things you're waiting for all of a sudden. This is the way the game has kind of deteriorated for them. You know, you're waiting for NIP to make a mistake, you're waiting for opportunities to split push and keep heroes on the two side lanes instead of going mid lane all the time. Right now, you have Dazzle doing his job again and split pushing, has the 5 roll support, and you've got it all the way towards the tier 3. But oh, you are eternally afraid and eternally scared of getting comboed by NIP again. You just do not want that to happen. You do not want to get found out by a vacuum wall into, you know, Santa's Eclipse.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and maybe that's why the clockwork is good there for pickoffs, but you need the Lina to be there as well. And then as soon as somebody shows after the initiation comes out, you kind of are in a tough pickle there as well. I will say the thing that's sort of tough for NIP is that they don't have, like, the greatest building hitters necessarily. There's good parts about Weaver in that he can do a lot of damage, but, you know, he's also, in a way, a little bit squishy, so if he ends up getting caught out fully, then he just ends up dying. Then you've got the issue with OD, who does a lot of damage to heroes, but can't really hit buildings that hard. So there might be some issues taking high ground for them.
Yeah, win condition for NIP at this point is win a team fight, you know, wipe them 3, 4, 5 heroes for maybe one or two losses, and then go high ground or force buybacks. Then you rinse and repeat with your next cycle of ultimates or next cycle of spells in a team fight. Whereas PD, they can walk up to enemy base and just hit it.
Right.
You know, they can just have TB illusions go and hit base. And at this point, you might even consider just like 4 or 5 manning and have one guy sit back to defend your tier threes or something, and maybe. Yeah, at some point, we might see some form of a base race or some form of an all-in from both teams.
Right.
Just because of how weird this interaction between them is.
Yeah.
But I think in most cases, NIP will like TP back to defend.
They want to take the fight. They are in the lead as far as that's concerned. And Pro Dota is here. They've got J4 in the area. Could have thrown out a heal bomb, but well, with TPs coming back, maybe they can find somebody on the backside of this. They've already gone on to Lina, though, trying to bring her down. BKB popped, the vacuum wall is there, but it didn't end up catching onto it. Doesn't matter, though. Era's found the kill, and now they bring in Garter, trying to take down and kill off this Weaver. Is going to end up falling. They get a big one right as the Aegis ended up going down. And now Trixie, he's going to be able to get out of there. So they find a big kill. They do lose their Lina for it. But in return, Milan also goes down, so it's kind of tough. It's still, like, not clean. Nothing is clean right here for Pro Dota.
Nothing's clean for either of these teams.
Yeah.
Yeah, everything has been kind of tentative. We're on a knife's edge at this point. You know, you don't want to make any big mistakes. OD TPing back to tier 2, I felt that was NIP's signal to either come back in force and TP to the shrine and try and backstab the two people that were pushing bot lane. Or they TP the OD back there and they have everyone else go to farm their own jungle and they just retreat that way. But the four heroes from NIP still committed onto tier 2 and weren't retreating as fast as maybe the OD thought they would. And they get caught in this weird disjointed fight where they still find the Lina, but losing Era there, that is really important for them because he was the one holding the Aegis.
Right. Yeah. And, I mean, it's... Ooh, they do get the D ward here as well. I was wondering if that one was going to get taken down. And it feels like it's enough of a momentum shift that, like, you can start to be more proactive around the map at least a little bit, particularly with the Aegis down. Questionable if you can actually make that type of movement again, like a big push towards one of the lanes. But bottom lane took some damage as well as mid. I would imagine they need another pickoff before they even either like really group up and do anything.
Is Nightstalker even close? They need another 1,000 gold. It's 2.5 minutes until nighttime. That could work for them. Yeah. I think they just bide their time for the next, you know, 2 minutes or so, wait things out, get Ags on Nightstalker. Because the most important thing that PD are missing right now is vision. They've just placed one Observer Ward in their own jungle, watching for, like, you know, points of ingress, entry routes into their jungle to see if NIP are coming down here to split push and set up for a fight. But their other ward is up on the top lane that's kind of a defensive one for when PD are pushing themselves up on the tier 3 top. So I don't know if they'll try and utilize the top ward and go in 5-man there where they have some vision already. Maybe, again, try and take control of enemy jungle, which is already heavily dewarded by all these sentries. But it's so hard. It's so hard to say. I think at this point there is like no clear-cut plan for PD. They have to react to what NIP do, while NIP are waiting for PD to do something so they can react and teamfight to what PD are doing. It's this kind of, who steps first? Who steps first?
Yeah. Well, and it's, I think that that Ags is going to be such a huge turning point, and it's also, like, further accentuated. Trixie picked up the gem, so even the wards that they're getting down in their own jungle are being taken away immediately. Scotty's a pretty big pickup, but it doesn't really change the status quo. It means those team fights are going to be easier to take, but if you don't know where to go and if you can't actually find the right target, and with all these force staffs sticking onto anybody is a nightmare as well. It feels like the path to winning a fight is so much easier for NIP right now, and they're taking advantage of it by constantly pushing in the lanes and trying to take down this bot or top tier 2 tower.
Yeah, unfortunately for J4, he misses out on an Observer Ward. Insania placed it not as deep as expected. Rubick just going to stand around and watch his creation as well, but tier 2 falls. No more outer towers for PD, while Kaiser...
Okay. There's a Shadow Blade away, but now you do have Light Strike Array. One of the better spells to steal.
And Roshan's up in like 25 seconds. Oh, well, I keep forgetting we have an actual timer now.
Yeah.
I've always like eyeballed it, and I always still like muscle memory, look to the pit, look at the timer, see how much time we've got left, but we actually have a thing that says 7 seconds until Roshan's back up.
That's great. That's just the best. Ooh, an Ancient Sack here going the way of Era. He is farmed. He is so crazy farmed.
He's still behind the TB. I think Odie has been the real miracle worker here, catching up to the Lina and overtaking her, and being as close to this TB as he is. Boxy's done an exceptional job. No, he's not fed. He's been in fights they needed to. He's made some swift little plays when needed. He's farmed exceptionally well.
Oh, they got him.
My question marks.
Oh, no, the force step. He gets to the other side of it, and the Wukong's command comes out from Hani as well. Just going to force them back. Vacuum 3-3. Gets the Yule Scepter, keeping him alive for the moment. They end up being able to catch now onto Trixie as well, and he is going to drop before he gets any spells off, really. Now can they take this fight any further? They're going to bring down one buyback from the Darkseer, but already Box is going to be controlled. They're trying to TP in this Darkseer. He's going to be able to be set up for a pretty big back combo, but there is still BKBs out for both of these heroes. Looking for his opening. Is it going to come? The Sanity's Eclipse is there. The vacuum came down.
Oh,
it doesn't end up coming. He's out of
Thunder.
There.
He got Thunder. Foxy's alive. Oh. Oh my God. He dodged Laguna with Astral. I cannot believe this.
What?
That is like the single luckiest thing I've seen in the past 6 months.
Oh my God. And now Insania is going to chase down. He does have Blink. He's found J4. The fact that you end up keeping the OD alive there. Oh man. Trixie will be able to find this kill finally. The gem on the deck. Did they get that on the courier?
No, they didn't. It was still on the floor. They've got 2 gems now on NIP. But that was so close to PD smashing that team fight. So close. Missed out on the kill on the OD. Didn't get the Sunder because of the fog. Couldn't catch onto any heroes. Got forced out forward. Even with a huge grave from J4 onto the TB in the middle of that fight, you know, kind of saved things for them. He managed to get himself a lot more damage out than really he was entitled to for his positioning. Thanks to the turnaround and the buyback from Trixie. NIP, I don't know. That single turning moment, the luckiness, you know, you can't really time it. You
right.
Probably know Laguna Blade's coming, you know the damage is coming, you're gonna self Astral there as your BKB ends because you Hurricane Piked away already. It was just the, you know, fortune that Kaiser didn't think of it. Look at that!
3-3.
What?
He's making the plays that his team needs. Alright, we've had some silly stuff in this game. And that's pretty up there as well. I mean it's clockwork, you know what's gonna happen. Did he have a flare over the top of him?
Yeah, he tried it 10 minutes ago, right?
Yeah.
He had to get it this time. Flare, hookshot. He even did it the other day. I can't remember who he was playing against, but that's the second time I've seen 3-3 snatch in ages this week.
All right, changes are coming, though. We have the Night Stalker Aghanim Scepter done. They don't have the gem anymore. They lost it on the Dazzle, but the fights are going to be better now.
Yeah, they'll definitely see the fights coming a lot sooner.
You won't get fogged your TB when you're going for the Sunder, as they are going to take the kill onto Insania there. That wasn't
too bad. Hey, you also see the Monkey King coming, which is a huge factor. You know, Monkey King has been playing this role where he's on trees, scouting out opportunities for his team, and kind of, you know, setting up team fights without actually casting any spells, just by giving vision. Whereas the initiation for NIP is pretty much the Darkseer.
Well, and in the meantime, I mean, you don't want to blow that combo either. Boundless Strike is there, Milan. They popped the Lincoln Sphere right at the start. Get the Silence off as well. On to Trixie. That was huge. He could knock it off his combo as he went for the jump forward, but now trying to find this kill here. Milan getting ran down. They do get the Sage Eclipse off, but Garter already popped his BKB, but now they don't have the vision. They're completely in the dark here. Garter getting ran down. He will manage. No, he got Astral. Okay, no. This is... Now, I thought that they caught him there, but they did not. They caught one of their buddies.
And J4 TP's out, the last one to leave. Only losing Milan there is, you know, kind of okay. It's not the best, but all of the ulties for NIP are coming back up again. Sandy's Eclipse, the one exception, so they'll have their vacuum wall, they'll have their combos. But look at the split push that's, you know, ready to come in. Top lane is being shoved. Insania comes back. I don't know if he's here to defend. I don't know if he's going to defend or try and scout Garter, because these illusions will just keep coming in onto your tier threes.
They're ready. Yeah, and here we go. A little bit of a movement in. I mean, it's still a lot of damage that's going to come out, but I think that you can probably get more here if you're NIP, nighttime. It's still a little ways away, I believe. You've got 3 minutes, so looks like they're still not willing to take that fight as of yet. They have everything pretty much up and online, the exception of Sanity's Eclipse.
But it's still really spooky, though, when you're pushing high ground with no vision. Like, this game has literally been 80% about vision. About yeah. Monkey King giving vision, Aghanim Scepter for Nightstalker giving vision, but just Observer Wards, being able to see your opponents when you're breaking these objectives. Hani has proven immensely important for NIP to get the advantage and lead that they have. But still, PD, they have, you know, Aegis Clockwork, dude. Aegis Clockwork.
Yeah, why not?
What, another two minutes? This could signal PD actually going and attempting to break high ground. They've got the things they need. They've got Metamorphosis. They kind of want the next night time, which is unfortunately 2.5 minutes away. So NIP are likely the ones that will just shove in again bot lane, try and get some vision down, and just keep their lanes pushed down. Yeah. That is their biggest struggle at this point in time, is that all the lanes are seemingly across their side of the river.
Well, and the thing that's interesting about it too is, like, the way that this game has gone, there's a pretty substantial experience difference, but in terms of net worth, they have the items that they need to take this fight. And as far as, like, Aegis carriers, there are worse ones you could pick than a Clockwork. Like, you probably would have taken Lina first and foremost, but, I mean, she has... Did she take the minus respawn time? No, she went for the damage. So I guess it's not really that fast of a respawn time with the Bloodstone, but Terrorblade, as soon as you pop meta, it's not like you're doing a ton in the fight when you come back. Anyways, you can just go in with it with Clockwork.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, Clockwork or Nightstalker would be the two heroes that I'd aim to give Aegis of the Immortal to, pretty much.
Ooh.
Blink Dagger for Milan. It's going to allow him to jump into the back lines and find the Darkseer. Silence him before he can get the vacuum wall off.
Look at this movement, though. They've got a jump forward here, and they have been able to find the Lina, who gets the BKB off, trying to run away. The right click's just not that significant after she gets the BKB off. So quick fingers there, and the smoke gank will be ostensibly dodged.
That's, like, meaningless for NIP, though. Arcane Rune on Trixie means that his vacuum is back off cooldown in 5 seconds anyway.
Okay.
Whereas Lina popped her BKB for it. So, you know, NIP poking and prodding, looking for this weakness in pro Dota. But again, the problem is Ira is on the other side of the map. He has to, you know, keep these lanes in check. He has to keep tabs on where Garter is, what he's doing. Like, fortunately for Nip, the TB doesn't have boosted travel. Right. That is, like, one of the biggest saving graces here, is that Terrorblade can't freely move from lane to lane. Mm-hmm.
But he does have a butterfly completed now, which will cause some other issues as well. On the Weaver, went for Maelstrom, obviously, and now is building towards the Scotty. Do you think that it's worth it after seeing this butterfly going back? Oh, wait, they found Monkey King? Okay, right click's coming through. They should be able to find that kill. Hani trying to get out, but the Rocket Flare will secure it.
Ah, I wonder how that happened.
It must have been this ward right here.
Okay. Oh, yeah, maybe it was.
I, like, saw the angle very, that very he close. Jumped.
And then you just LSA the tree down, I guess.
Yeah. Oh.
That's a good pick.
OD taking a second to think about their decisions in life as well. Need to figure out what's happening.
But yeah, you bring up a great point with the butterfly on TB. How do they deal with it? Because OD is naturally good against illusions with Arcane Orb, but if he's missing so many attacks, then obviously he loses a lot of that efficiency.
Yeah.
But OD like never wants to buy MKB. He wants to stack up as much int and mana pool as he possibly can. I would think that Era will change from Skadi to Monkey King Bar, but maybe he feels that he's not tanky enough yet.
Yeah.
Maybe he feels that, you know, buying stats and just padding out his HP total is much more important than dealing with a Terrorblade, because we've seen from these fights that they've been able to kill off pretty much everyone before the, like, sort of at the start of the fight, you know, pick off the targets they need, the Dazzle, the Clock, the Nightstalker, and then leave the TB to last.
Oh, look at this. They found Era. That's a quick jump in. Nobody is there at all. And he's just gonna drop. Okay, there.